Bon dia a tothom. Comencem amb la segona conferència de la jornada d'avui. Si em permeten, faré aquesta breu presentació en anglès per referència al nostre convidat. Bueno, com podeu veure pel títol, anem a parlar sobre les bones pràctiques al cas danès. Good morning to everyone, and especially good morning to Mr. Henrik Søndergaard. On behalf of the Catalan Communication Society, we would like to thank you for being here with us and accept our invitation to our conference. For us, it's an honor to have you here and share some of your time to talk about the public media services in Denmark. With your permission, I would like to explain to our audience some relevant details about your academic profile in order to introduce you. So Dr. Henrik Søndergaard is Associate Professor at Media, Cognition and Communication Department of the University of Copenhagen. His primary research areas are public service broadcasting, Danish media policy, European media regulation, and media economy. He currently heads the Danish part of an European research project called MediaDem, European Media Policies Revisited, Valuing and Reclaiming Free and Independent Media in Contemporary Systems, funded by the European Union. And today, Dr. Søndergaard will talk about the good media practices in Denmark. So thank you again for being here with us. So the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me. Nice to see you here. Yes, I'm proud to have the chance to talk about Danish public service media. I guess somehow the Danish media system is quite famous. This is a quotation from the former director general of the Danish main broadcast institution, DR. He's talking about the Nordic countries, including Denmark, as a kind of public service wonderland. And this is really fantastic, of course. But as I will demonstrate to you, it's not just a paradise, there's at least some snakes in that. We will see. What I'm going to talk about is those three issues here, the development of public service media in Denmark. I think you need to have some basic understanding of it in order to understand what is so fantastic about it. Secondly, I will focus on the digital strategies in Danish public service media. And I will end my presentation with touching briefly on some of the media policy issues at stake in Denmark. I guess this is pretty much the same kind of things that Karen has been talking about today. You need some background features. I have the chance to give you all the slides I have. I have printed a lot of slides because my English is so poor. So I have the slides. You can have them. I can send them to you and you can... Yeah. Distribute them though. So, okay, so you don't have to write everything down.
We can put it on yeah. Blog.
Yeah, okay. But you have, most European countries are small. Denmark is really, really small. 5.5 million people live there. It's quite a wealthy country, and it's a relatively well educated population. We have a welfare state. I guess you also have some kind of welfare state, but we have one. We are proud of that. And another thing that we have to mention is that it's a very, very homogeneous population. So we don't have conflicts between north and south and east and west and Catalonia and Spain and so on. We don't have these things. And that's important. I want very, very briefly to refer to what I guess is common knowledge to you, Helin and Messina's very famous media models, because I think they do explain a lot of things that is important when discussing public service media around Europe. They are different, and there are reasons why they're different. And you can, on this place, you can find Denmark, and in this your left corner, and you find Spain up in the top. I guess you know the Helin Messina's concepts and the ideas, but what is characteristic of this? Democratic cooperative media model is that you have a high newspaper circulation, political parallelism, we have early mass circulation press and so on, strong professionalization, which is important, and we have, and that's today is the most important thing, very strong public service broadcasting institutions. What is characteristic of the political system in this democratic model? I mentioned it here. The most important thing is the welfare state. And that thing, you have to pay attention to that, because often when you are comparing media from different countries, you are discussing, can we transfer that to another country? I think if you really want to transfer the whole system, you have to somehow transfer the whole package, including the kind of welfare state. There are different kinds of welfare states. I won't go into details with that, but in the Danish kind of the Nordic welfare states, it's called the universal welfare state, which is different from what you find in Southern Europe, which is called the selective, and the Anglo-American type, which is called the residual, a smaller liberal kind. I won't go into details here, but just to mention that, this is the dimension of Helena Mazzino's model, which could be elaborated far more than they have been doing themselves. What is characteristic of a universal welfare state that is, in terms of media, media are regarded as public goods? Secondly, the question of editorial independence or media independence is taken very, really seriously. It's a really important thing then. Also, media policy is regarded as part of cultural politics. This has been some from the beginning, and it's still so, even though many other kinds of politics are involved. Moreover, media policy making, it's oriented toward consensus, in the sense that all actors involved are invited to participate. And I think also it's important, especially if you want to have a peaceful media system going on. Finally, the idols behind this is that people are equal somehow. It's some kind of socialism in a weak form involved here, I guess. At the cultural policy level, you see that culture is regarded not just something you have to preserve or protect, but it actually operates like a political force, a social force that is important in achieving overall societal goals. Moreover, there's the idea that culture is for everybody, the idea of bringing the culture to the people. Of course, in a small country, there's also put effort on preserving the national culture. And finally, one of the quite important issues that from the beginning and so far, cultural policy has a component of anti-commercialism. I will go into explain a little bit more about that. If we look at the relationship between public service broadcasting the universal welfare state, the idea that public service broadcasting is a universal service is quite important. And the implication of that is that there's a very strong focus on having high reach in your broadcasting or in your media services. This is a strategic goal. So it's not the idea that public service broadcasting is for the elite or for the better educated or older people or anything like that. The fundamental idea is that it's for everybody. The implication of that is that you have an idea of having a comprehensive programming obligations covering all kinds of program, covering all kinds of needs in principle. And again, the idea of being politically and economic independence is quite important, seen as a precondition for achieving goals like that. Looking at Helena Machinin, we often get the impression that the social structure, the media history, somehow decides how you are going to organize your media. I do think that there's also a lot of action going on, that politicians decide which kind of media policy they want to achieve. So I want to stress that by showing that, seen from this public service media wonderland, we also look out in the world and say things that we don't like. First of all, we don't like the Americans with their commercial culture. So that's pretty much anti-American attitude in the television environment. Secondly, we also look with fear, or we did at least, down in Europe, and the very, very bad guys were those in Italy. It was really rubbish, and there wasn't any control of anything. We didn't like that. So we have this somehow kind of polarized thinking, not only what we want to achieve ourselves, but what we want to avoid. And at least in media policy debates in Denmark, this has been really, really important. You have to remember that public media in Denmark was, as in most other countries, at the beginning a monopoly. This has changed late 1980s, which is pretty late, but it did. And from that time and on, we have started to think at public service broadcasting, public service media as part of a wider system. And we also have this kind of dual media system with public and private media existing side by side. And I think this is really an important thing happening for public service media, that they really became public service media in the widest sense, first when they got the competition from commercial broadcasting. Because before that time, they were pretty much closer to the state. Now they have turned down this line, getting closer to the market. And in my opinion, it's very important. Secondly, when you have this kind of media system, you have to realize you are now living in a system with a media ecology. You cannot just take care of the market, or you cannot just take care of the public service broadcast. You have to take care of both sides of it. And this is, of course, a much more difficult task than just looking at the public service broadcasters that we did 20 years ago, or just looking at how can business have a nice time as they do in the States or places like that. I was asked, to say something about public service media's contribution to democracy, and I just mentioned something here. I won't go into details, not because I think it's uninteresting, but I think it's more about the media structure. But as you see, informing people, giving rise to public debates, creating, sustaining identities. This is, I think, is common to many public service broadcasters. It's common in Denmark as well. And I don't think there's much dispute about that. As you see, there's also some newer tasks for public service media and their role in democracy. The idea of engagement and empowerment is upfront in Denmark. The Danish public service broadcast talked about the contribution to strengthen the citizens' capacity to participate in democracy. And this is the main goal these days. That's the media literacy, which has become increasingly important. I think that the Danish media system or the Danish public service media tries to do some that on that. Lastly, the idea of building communities. This is, of course, still more important as the media system generally leads to fragmentation, and that our social systems are leading to further fragmentation. I basically find that there are three different roles that public service media can play in the media system, and I think they in Denmark play all the three roles, being an alternative to the commercial media. That had been the idea for the last 20 years or so, and it is still so. And one of the tasks is that they compensate for market failures. They fill in where the market doesn't do. And in such a small country as Denmark, 5 million people, there's a lot of things for public service broadcasters to do because the market cannot afford to any real diversity. And then certainly innovation, the public service media has the money to do that, and to some extent they are really also doing it. It is a kind of a first mover in many digital areas in Denmark, as is in the other Nordic countries as well. Yeah, I think that we also have to be clear that being in a dual media system is an advantage for public service media. Dreaming of a situation in which public service media are ruling the market, I think is nothing to dream about, really. I think that looking at the Danish and the Nordic systems, the day you got competition, the public service broadcasters, public service media started to become user-friendly. They started to pay interest to the viewers and listeners and users. Secondly, at least in the Nordic countries, the competition from commercial broadcasters have made public service media institutions extremely cost-efficient. They produce 10 times as much as they did before, with almost the same amount of employees. And I do also think that even in a small country as Denmark, the commercial broadcasters are contributing to diversity within that system, and that we have to pay attention to that. Yes. Now I'll give you a brief introduction to what is how does public service look in Denmark? And it's a rather complicated system, actually. You have to remember we only 5.5 million people, and we're paying for this bloody lot of public service system here. On the top, we have the DR. It's the old monopolist institution, totally license fees. It runs a lot of radio channels, television channels, online. It was established in 1925. Then we have TV2, which is a little bit odd construction. It's public owned, it's funded by commercials and subscription from quite recently. And it has a television channel, and it runs also, but not as a public service business, but as kind of private business, and a number of subscription channels. They are somehow funding this national TV2 channel. Then we have a system of eight regional channels. They are funded by a license fee. Quite recently, we have this very, very strange thing. We have a private company having public license fee money to run a national radio channel. It's called Radio 24/7. I think Denmark must be the land that in country that invented this kind of radio channel. And then we also have a public service fund. It's funded by license fee money, and private broadcasters can ask for money from this fund up to 50%, and then they have to broadcast these programs on the commercial channels. The idea is that also commercial broadcasters can distribute public service content. It is a kind of controversial construction, and that is that. Just to give you an idea of how strong public service media are in Denmark, you look at this figures here. They are for 2012. Things hasn't changed that much. So if we look at radio, you can see that DR, the National Public Service Broadcast, has a very, very strong market share, almost 80%. And if you look at television, the two public service broadcasters together have more than half of the market. And if you look at the internet ranking, they are ranked as number 3 and number 4. So they have, I guess you can say, you have a dominant position in Denmark. At the bottom of the scheme, you see the two major commercial broadcasters, the MTG, which operates in all the Nordic countries and some of the Eastern Europe, and the SBS Discovery, who also operates in more or less the same areas. They are actually not Danish companies. They are operating from the UK, from London, and they are not in part of the Danish jurisdiction, which is somehow a problem. But anyway, here you see at least that the evidence that public service media are still pretty strong. Why are they so strong? Yeah, one of the reasons is that the Danish market is so small that it's not really, really interesting for big companies to be there. But most important, I think, that there's a huge political support to public service media in Denmark as there is in most other Nordic countries. It is not just defending, that it goes up and down. The left wing parties are more in favor of public service than the right wing parties. But due to the fact that if we didn't have public service media in Denmark, we would have only discount media or trash anyway. So it's not difficult to convince politicians that public service media are important. As I say here, we have sufficient funding. Of course, you can always discuss that, but I do think that is almost the case. We have also a relatively clear mandate. I mean, there's a lot of discussing, is the mandate clear enough? But I think it's so far quite clear. And one very, very important thing is that public service media has large audiences, so they are popular media as well. There are two policy goals in Danish media policy. One is directed at strengthening the public service broadcasting or public service media, protecting them against too much competition, giving them the right to expand into having niche channels, and to expand into what we call new media on new digital services. At the same time, we have another strategy going on which has the aim of reducing the size and the powers of public service media. Part of it is a kind of Danish media policy going on. The idea of outsourcing programs to a private company, the idea of contract steering, the idea of establishing the public service fund, whereas the last two components are actually not, as you know, something that the Danes invented. This is the European media policy, and perhaps, I don't know, today I put that in the slide about reduction of PSM, because I don't think it actually has to be so. It depends on how the local government chooses to interpret those ideas. But anyway, you have to realize we started with having a public service value test, and it took some years before we got the other part of it, the market impact test. And so far, the market impact test has not been in use. We'll wait to see what happens the first time it happens. Looking at what the Danish media, public service media, has been doing in the digital area, we again it seems to be that we are quite famous. Here's a quite young scholar, Benedetta Brevini, in her new book, Public Service Broadcasting Online. She's really fond about Denmark, and I have to say, I think that she's too fond of it. I think it has to do with the people she has been talking with. But again, the idea that it's some kind of wonderland. What have happened? I'll only talk about DR. Let the other public service organizations aside because it takes too much time then. I think that you find Danish public service media regarding the internet as a new media, actually, the third platform, radio, television, and then the web. And at the same time, and I think that is the most dominant position, is that they regard the web as a kind of extension of radio, and in particular of television. And I think this is more or less the same story as Karin was pointing at. So even in Wonderland, they cannot do more than that. There are three strategies involved. The first of them is the development of multi-channels, niche channels. The second one is the developing of online services, and the third one is the development of cross-media production and cross-media supply. If we look at the first strategy, part of this was the switch over from analog to digital. As you remember, in many countries there was a fear that public service broadcasts would never go digital, but stay analog and would die that way. It didn't happen in Denmark, and it hasn't happened anywhere as far as I know. So it was realized when in 2006 and 2009, when the analog distribution system was switched off, then we have a full digital distribution system in Denmark. And in the beginning, DR got three new digital channels. They have two channels before, and they run unsuccessful 24 hours news channel. The most important thing about this part of the strategy was the development of a new channel structure in DR. And you can see it here. We have the mainstream channel, DR1. You have a news, a debate, DR2. You have one for young people, one for culture. And you have two different channels for kids, one for very small kids and one for little older kids, so to speak. So this is pretty much the model you find, for instance, on BBC. And you still have to remember, we are only 5.5 million people. This is only one public service organization running all those channels. The second strategy concerning online strategies, it started in late 1990s with experiments, as in many other countries, and already in year 2000, online services became a formal part of the public service remit, and this is quite important. It meant that DR was now able to expand in that area, and nobody else did, so there were quite open space to go into. What is it today? It's online news, online textual news is a very important thing. It's the live streaming of everything that we have on ordinary radio and television. You can have it on the net as well. Then you have a catch-up service like the BBC Player. 60% of the programs you can find there, in particular the programs that DR made themselves. You have a podcast system, have been going on for a long time for radio. And then you have the program Archive. It's called Bonanza. And today it contains about 3,000 programs. They are all programs because all the copyright issues have to be cleared. But when programs are produced by DR themselves and they are old enough, they are put on this archive. And the archive was partly financed by the state as a kind of digital preservation of the cultural heritage. So it's growing slowly and perhaps too slowly. And then, of course, every program has a web page. I think you have seen that in many, many countries. In the last part of it is there are special sections for teaching schools, high schools, health, food, and so on. And there's mobile services. They are not that big, but they are, and they are expanding. And then you also have, in the end, chats and blogs. It's not... The idea was that it would be quite important and occupy quite a big space on the web pages, but it doesn't. The search strategy, I say, is the one that hasn't been really developed. It's the idea of producing to all three platforms at one at the same time. The idea, as you know, I think you know it from the BBC, the idea of 360 degrees production is also an idea catched by the Danish broadcasting or public service media. But so far they don't really do it. It's difficult. The organizational structure works against it. Television is so important. It's very, very difficult. But you find it in certain campaigns. We are going to have the European, what is called, melody competition, song contest. And you will there you will find that we have, it's everywhere, on radio, on television, on the web. And you find it when you have different campaigns or elections and so on. The overall program policy goal hasn't really changed, even though that the media system has changed and the distribution platform has changed. The idea is still to serve all kinds of audiences and to be distinct. And as so far, the idea is that you have to be popular in order to function as a public service media. And you have this classical dilemma between having a high share and getting a high reach. I will come back to that. But in the first hand, you can see this reach question. If you look at radio, television, you can see that DR has a really high reach. Almost 90% of the people are on a weekly basis watching DR television. On the net, it's not that much. But the interesting thing here is that you can see that younger people are more difficult to reach. And this is, I think, it's true all over Europe. And it's really an issue with DR. And the interesting thing is that this difference between older and younger people in terms of reach is not the same on the net. And that's one of the reasons why DR put so much effort on developing services to younger people on the net. This topic, Manco Reach, I don't know what is the proper English name, but it refers to people who are listening to radio but don't listen to DR radio, or watching television without ever watching any DR programs. And that is, of course, the real problem that somebody doesn't use this universal service. And one of the fundamental things that I think people who are working with broadcasting know that in order to have a high reach, you need to have a relatively high share as well. It is difficult to plan a media system that goes for REITs. The way to do it is to have to look at having high shares sometimes in order to have this high REITs. And if you want to have any contact to younger people, at least in Denmark, you can do everything on the net, and you can make youth channels and so on. But the main audience, also among young people, you get by having very popular programs on the mainstream channel. And I think that so far I haven't really seen any evidence that you can do that in another way. Looking at this REITs problem, you can see that DR has focused quite recently to say, okay, our online services is about news, it's about radio, it's about television. So they have those three sections. Before it was much broader than now. And the entire website, it's called DRDK, also addresses an audience. In principle, it addresses all the Danes, but in practical terms, it's designed in order to catch the young adults. Because people with children and the children, they are actually using DR and they're using the websites. And as I mentioned before, the part with dialogue, it seems to play, it has always been played a marginal role, and it seems to become more and more marginalized, even though the broadcasters in official papers say that they really want to have that. I think they find it difficult to do it and find difficult to spend all the money that probably is needed to do that. Just to show you that there's a reason why the website is organized the way it is. You can see that most of the use is on news, and secondly, it's on television. I'm going to end by pointing at what is gained and what is the problems with this transformation from analog to digital, this expansion within the digital system. I think all in all, public service, the transformation from public service broadcasting to public service media has already taken place. Of course, you can discuss, is it really public service media, or has it to develop further? Yes, it has to develop further. But there's no risk in Denmark that public service media will be put at the side as a public service broadcaster alone. I think that then DR has avoided this worst case scenario, that they will lose the contact with the audience due to technical or technological reasons. Secondly, you can see that actually DR has increased their reach due to niche channels and due to the online services. It also, of course, have extended diversity and to some extent distinctiveness. And I think in media policy debates, one of the channels that DR made is called DRK. It is DR Culture, a cultural channel. Before we got that, a lot of people at my age, at my profession, were very, very worried about all this entertainment and lack of culture and enlightenment in public service broadcasting. And then we got this new channel, and then peace has come to this critique. And I think it's quite important also for the overall media policy that it happened. I do also think that the dialogue with the audience have increased. There's a lot of Every program has a kind of chat function. It's much easier to complain about programs, and there are a lot of complaints. 50,000 complaints a year in DR. And that is not because they are bad, but that's because they have an open system for making complaints. Lastly, I want to point that, say, okay, the idea that some kind of public service values should go should also be applied to the internet. If you believe in that, then I think that having public service broadcasters to operate on the internet is one of the most efficient ways to extend those values. The problems. Yeah, quite obviously, the transformation from analog to digital meant that instead of having two television channels and four radio channels, DR now has six television channels and 11 radio channels and web pages and catch-up services and online anything. So it's a very, very big business now. In terms of television program, the expansion has been, I say, 300% from 2008, before digitalization, until 2012, without much more money. It's difficult to have the quality and the diversity that you really want. So, in my opinion, somehow you have built a system which is perhaps too big to be funded. I come back to that. Secondly, having more channels, having more services, cannot else but contribute to the fragmentation of the audience. The argument for doing is that everybody else are making niche channels, so we have to do the same. And then, of course, we have this criticism from commercial media. Karen told us that was a kind of conflict from the 1980s, wasn't it? Should be, yes. In Denmark, it's really, really hot stuff these days. There's a huge campaign going on saying that the problem with Denmark is not that public service broadcasting is too weak or improper. No, the problem is public service broadcasting or public service media are far too big. It's going to kill the newspapers and the commercial broadcasters and the cable television companies and so on. So this is a problem. And I do also think that the rise of the digital system and the transformation for public service broadcasters to public service media does require a rethinking of what it means to what public service really means, how should the public service remit be defined. Because you can say, the old critic saying, well, some parts of the program, for instance, entertainment or American movies, they are not really public service broadcasting, are they? Public service broadcasters have survived this critique by saying, okay, it's part of a schedule, and when you do schedules, you need to have those in order to make people watch the real stuff, the news, and so on. But what about thematic channels? Channels with only cultural programs, okay, they are public service. Channels with only American movies, they are not. So the problem you have with programs is now extended to be a problem about channels when you run a multi-channel thing. And it's of course also a problem in online systems. In a schedule, you can say we have this soap opera because it leads the audience to watch the news. But in an online demand system, you don't have the means to prevent the audience from just downloading the soap and let the news program stay alone on the server. Of course, you can invent ideas. I don't have time to do it here, but in other forums, I have tried to develop an idea of a kind of public service recommendation system in an online on-demand system, which will somehow, in a technical way, put the topic of paternalism back on the agenda. But that might be some other day, I think. I'm going to finish pretty soon. But the question about how to define public service media activities, I mean, we all know in the beginning it was about institutions. Being DR, everything that DR did was public service. This idea doesn't work anymore. Then it was the idea of public service as particular programming, this kind of mixed scheduling, as we all know. This idea is still alive, but I think it's more and more the idea that public service media is about a particular kind of programs. It's news, it's national drama, children's program, and so on. And this is, of course, the dangerous strategy, I think, because this makes it far more difficult to sustain a public service as a universal service. So what the Danish or the DR's answer to that is what is the end of this slide here, namely the idea, no, it's not about our programming, it's not about particular programs, it's not about being DR. The point is that we have an impact on society. We have a political, social, cultural impact on society. And this, of course, requires that the politicians say, it's okay, we don't care, we don't intervene. Because when you start to think that way, you are, in terms of political pressure, you will run a risk. And I think that this is possible in Denmark due to the kind of political traditions we have. The real problem today really is this problem of the critique from the commercial media. As we all know, the financial crisis has made it much more difficult to run commercial media. Development of international online media has made it much more difficult to fund journalism due to with advertising. So the press is really in deep trouble in Denmark, and one thing is that the commercial broadcasters are a problem. I mean, Danish politicians would usually say, we don't really care. They live in London, okay, it's not our business. But that the presses have problem is a problem that the politicians will have to take care of. Secondly, DR has launched a youth channel. This is a real problem for the commercial broadcasters because they have this precisely the same audience of young people. The Catch Up services, the on-demand service that DR has developed, is also now becoming a problem for cable companies that find that people don't want to buy those expensive cable packages when you can have online content from your public service broadcaster. Right now, this spring, there's a media policy negotiation going on in Denmark in order to make a media policy agreement for the next 4 years, and all those issues here are on the agenda. We will see how it ends up, but I think that it's about time in Denmark that the politicians start really to realize that we are living in a world with a dual system, that we have to take into account that we also need to look at the private market. The question thinking about different kinds of divisional labor between private and public media, and also different kinds of cooperation. And I think one of the perhaps most important questions that nobody really asks at the time in Denmark is that, do we have too much or too little public service, or have it the right size? And I think that we need to find out on that. And I don't think we can ask the market to give the answer. And I'm sorry to say, we cannot ask the public service media themselves to give the answer. I think that we need to have somebody else to find the answer. And I guess that one of the solutions will be that we have a more comprehensive investigation and research on that topic. It has just started in Denmark to think this way, but I think it will be the way forward. And I do hope that when we come to that, it will not only be discussion about competition as it has been so far, but it will be also a discussion that takes into account the cultural aspiration that we still have in the Danish society. Yes, I don't have the answers, but it's worth thinking about. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Henry, for your interesting presentation. Now we have a very clear idea why we are so far from the Nordic models. You are maintaining the balance. We are trying to look for the balance. We are looking for the balance, still looking for. So maybe now we can open the debate to the audience. So, el temps per obrir el debat amb vosaltres. Si veig per la final, primera pregunta, sí.
Thank you, Enric. I would like to know if there are some statistics of, or you know, what is the opinion of citizens in Denmark about the public service media, and also which mechanisms do citizens have to have access to the public service media to?
The last question I didn't.
People think
they're
bad. Yeah. And the second is if the population has some access to the public media, so he can participate, or what kind of access they have directly to the public.
Yeah. Yes. The first question. There's a lot of surveys being made every year, I guess, about what does the population think about public service media and public service broadcasting. The general impression is that there's a rather huge support of it. But I think it's not just because of DR, which have been the main topic today, but also because of the other public service broadcaster, TV2, which is more, has a more popular appeal, I think those two institutions taken together are covering, in practical terms, all kinds of program, all kinds of what you could think being a part of public service broadcasting, and therefore you can say that there's also a big popular support to public service broadcasting, public service media. I don't have the figures with me today, but it is part of it. And I do believe that the Danish public service media are very much aware of that. They are not going to rely on the politicians. They're going to rely on the public support they get. And this is one of the reasons why they are so eager to have popular programming, even though they got a lot of criticism for that from a minority, of course. The second question, do the Danish people have a chance to come in contact, discuss with the public service broadcasters? Yes, they have. Besides from the websites, and we have a kind of media ombudsman, who is actually not a part of DR. He is an independent institution, taking care of a lot of the complaints and taking complaints seriously as well. Moreover, we have a system in DR where the management and the board and are traveling around in Denmark, having meetings with the people, so to speak, talking about programs, talking about strategies, and so on. And there's a dialogue. And there's also, they also have a kind of internet panel in which everybody actually can contribute and evaluate the actual programs. So there's a lot of contact, but still, I mean, it's managed in a way that fits the institution. I don't think they so far want to go that much further.
Si hi ha alguna pregunta més en format breu, intentarem respondre. Val, la última,
I'm very short. Because we are on top of the line. I will be very brief. So, you mentioned that there is difficult to define national public media in a fragmented world with fragmented audiences. What about the topic of immigration, the inclusion of other people, which is not defined as national in the Nordic countries? What happened in the case of public service in media? How are they included or not in this kind of programming?
Yeah, they are not very much included. As you know, immigration is a hot topic in Denmark. They have radio services on a lot of different languages in order to make some kind of integration. But otherwise, I think that this is a problem that ethnic minorities are more or less excluded from this idea of delivering a universal service.
Thank you, Harry. We have to put here the end because we are out of the schedule. Thank you.